Absorbed in prayer, Ignatius once walked along the river to St. Paul Church, a little more than 1 mile outside of Manresa. When he had walked for a while, he sat down by the wayside and looked at the river. And as he sat there, his eyes opened within him. Everything appeared to him in a new light. It was as if he had become a different person, since he recognized God's work in everything. Ignatius of Loyola was born in 1491 in Spain. He was a member of the minor nobility and had great desires, great dreams to advance his family, his name, and to do heroic deeds. In a battle in Pamplona in Spain, he was wounded by a cannonball and was forced to return to his castle at Loyola to recover. During that time, he read two books, The Lives of the Saints and The Life of Christ, and was inspired by those books in dreaming to think not so much of his old dreams for glory and advancement, which left him dry and sad, but thought more about following Christ and doing great deeds for the Lord as the saints did, and that gave him a great joy and consolation. As part of his desire to follow the Lord, he decided to make a pilgrimage to the Holy Land and set out for Barcelona to take the boat. Because of the plague, he was not able to enter into Barcelona and so remained in a small town, Manresa, living in a cave. It was there that the Lord began to teach him as a teacher would teach a schoolboy about his new spiritual life. He moved from inward looking to outward looking, and his experience of the discernment of spirits, of understanding what God wanted for him, became the basis for the book that he would write, The Spiritual Exercises, which would help the church and help us even today to discern spirits and to find out what the Lord wants for us. The Spiritual Exercises of Saint Ignatius is a period of exercises that cover 4 weeks. They focus on our sinfulness, on our creation by God, on the decision of God to incarnate into the world in Jesus Christ, the following of Christ, his crucifixion and the resurrection, leading to the final experience of being sent into the world to help proclaim the gospel of Christ. Those 4 weeks become the basis for a Jesuit's understanding of the mission that they're given.
Thank you.
The spiritual exercises of Ignatius begins with the principle and foundation in first week, where we are asked to reflect in our createdness, that we were made by God to love God, to serve God, and to do good. But then we quickly understand that we don't always do what we're created for. There's sinfulness, there's brokenness. And after coming to grips with the fact that we are not what we are called to be, Ignatius introduces a central meditation, the contemplation on the incarnation. And he invites us to see the world as God sees the world. He asks us to look with the eyes of the Trinity, to see a world that is broken, that is in darkness, that is filled with sinfulness and violence, and to see the discussion, to hear the discussion of the Trinity, of what can be done to remedy this. And the decision to send the second person, to send Christ into the world, to help bring the good news, to invite us to do good, to avoid the sins that we've committed, and to make that reign of God known. In doing that, Ignatius also invites us to respond. How do we feel? What do we see? What do we decide to do based on what we have experienced in that contemplation? In praying a contemplation, Ignatius gives us a very interesting method. He asks us first to place ourselves in the presence of the Lord and to find a peacefulness, to be attentive to everything that God wants to say to us. And then the second stage is to ask for what we want, to see what the Lord sees, to give us the graces that we need to follow Christ. The next scene, now that we're calm, now that we have a sense of what we want, is to place ourselves in the scene, a little bit like going to the movies, to see and imagine what the Trinity saw, what God sees. Who is there? What are the actions that they perceive in the world? To be in the scene, to feel it, to sense it, to apply all of our knowledge to that, and to be very aware of how we feel, how we sense the world that God sees. In doing that, Ignatius invites us to become personally involved in the contemplation. It is our imagination. It is what we see. It is what we experience, shared obviously with God. And in that perspective, then, we come with our own desires, our own feelings, our own fears and joys, our own things that we want to ask or tell the Lord in a colloquy, in a conversation, in a very simple dialogue with the Lord. And that comes from the heart. It comes from the experience of what we've seen and sensed. And that is the fruit of the meditation. We end, perhaps, to make it a formal ending with an Our Father or a Hail Mary, so that we don't just simply move into a distraction. And that helps us to block the time, to make it a movie that has a beginning, a middle, and an end. And finally, Ignatius and many people who have done the exercises suggest that we take some notes. What were the things that were really important for us in that contemplation, so that we can look back later and see and remember and have that experience of the contemplation that we had the first time? Another meditation that Ignatius asks us to make in the spiritual exercises is the meditation on the two standards, or two banners. Ignatius uses images from his life, from his experience, of two armies arrayed in battle, Babylon and Jerusalem, good versus evil, the white knight versus the evil black knight. Those seem a little bit strange to us today, but in fact, many of the experiences are the same. We have to make decisions in our own lives. Sometimes we choose good, sometimes we choose evil. And many times we find that the decisions are not so clear. There's a lot of gray area. And we are always trying to decide what we should do good and how to know what that good is in the eyes of God. In the following story, Tim and Scott are playing soccer. And it will give us an insight into what Ignatius was trying to have us pray.
Come on. Hand. Breath. Hand. That was a hand. That was a hand. You have to admit it.
Now that he's already given the goal?
So you admit it. Ref, he admitted it. He played his hand. Ref, do something.
Accept the decision.
Coach, he admitted it. But the ref won't do anything. He played his hand.
Ref, are you blind?
Hey, one more word and you're off the field, okay?
Yourself.
Hand.
Hand.
Hand?
Hand.
Hand?
It was so hand.
Come on, who found me in the penalty area last game and didn't say anything? Who?
Nobody saw it.
Yes, but I did.
Well, except you.
You too.
You touched the ball with your hand. You did it on purpose.
My foul wasn't intentional.
That goal was deserved, so deserved.
I don't blame you, but still, it was a hand.
And yet you got a yellow card for complaining. That's just life.
Hand.
Yes, hand. The hand of God.
You're not Madonna.
Maradona, it's Maradona.
And you insult God, hand.
God's
hand.
God's
hand.
God's
hand.
God's
hand.
God's
hand.
As we've seen from the last story, the question is not about winning or losing, but about doing what is right. As the two boys play, they realize that while it's good to win, it's also very important to have a good relationship, to be honest, to have integrity, to play the game the way it's supposed to be played. It's a simple thing and a momentary decision, but it impacts longer-term relationships, longer-term decisions. In the same way, we're invited in our own lives to choose good or evil, knowing well that we will not always be consistent, that we will make mistakes. But where do we want to be? How does God want us to act? How do we make the habit of doing what God asks us to do? That's the call of the two standards. Ignatius suggests three criteria. The first, and the most simple, of course, is that we're called to do good, to avoid sin. So if the decision is about doing something that is sinful, it's fairly easy. We shouldn't do that. But we're often confronted with different goods. The second criteria is, how do I help advance the mission of Christ in the world? How do I help others? How do I make my community better? If the good that I'm contemplating helps others, then that's a greater good. It's something that maybe I'm called to. But then Ignatius introduces the third criteria, which is, how do I feel in making that decision? Do I feel consoled? Do I feel like I'm doing what God is asking me to do? Am I happy with what I'm asked to do? If that is lacking, then perhaps we're called to do another good. Perhaps God is calling us to another mission, another action. And so Ignatius asks us to consider not only whether something is good, whether it's good for the reign of God, but also how it consoles us, how we find our life with God improved. If Ignatius begins the exercises by asking us to look inward, to see and understand why we were created, to love God, to be with God, to reverence God, and then asks us to reflect on Jesus's life in the world and our following of Jesus and our loving Jesus and our becoming as Christ-like as we can, knowing that in the midst of that following, there will be the cross. There will be times of failure. There will be times of crisis. There will be times of pain. But that we know that following that pain is the resurrection, that we're called to come into the presence of God once again. The final contemplation of the exercises is on the love of God, that very act that follows the resurrection, of beginning to see the world with the eyes of God, to understand the love of God as God loves us. It's not so much what we do or even how we do it, but the fact that we know that what we are doing because of God's love, as we'll see in the next scene. In the contemplation to obtain divine love, Saint Ignatius asks us to put ourselves in the position of seeing ourselves in front of the entire heavenly court, of being with God, and then to consider all of the good things, all of the blessings that we have received up until now, and to meditate and to feel how we feel about that. And then Ignatius makes the point that love is shown more in action than in words. We can speak about love, but it's how we care for one another. It's how we become one with the other that shows love. In the end, love is not above or below, but of equality, of being with the other. That's what Ignatius asks us to experience in obtaining divine love. And then he suggests a prayer of self-offering. Take, Lord, and receive all my liberty, my memory, my understanding, and all of my will, all that I have and all that I possess. You have given all these things to me. I now give it back to you. All of it is yours. Dispose of it according to your will. Give me love of yourself, along with your grace. That is enough for me. as we saw in the story of Scott's end, Scott was asked to give everything, his memory, his strength, all of his past, he has to let go of. But he understands for the good. He receives God's love and God's grace, and that's what carries him through to the end. All of us are called to be like Scott, to gradually realize it's not the things that we have, our memories, our power. It's what we give up. It's putting all of our life, all of our things at the disposition of God and allowing God to do with us as he will, all the way to the end. With that, we have enough and need nothing more. The exercises end with the contemplation of obtaining divine love, and the spiritual exercises come to an end. But many talk about the fifth week, the rest of our lives, that in the end, Ignatius wants this prayer to transform us, to help us to love with the love of God, to see the world as Jesus Christ sees the world, to follow Jesus Christ and to be Jesus for others, and also to see the face of Jesus Christ in others, to find him in the daily things, to look for where we can make Christ more present in the world. That is the gift of the spiritual exercises of Saint Ignatius to us, that prayer becomes action, and that action becomes God's action. Thank you.